You know, I don't get out much at the best of times, but seeing as how I'm now required by the government to... oh, what was the term? Social distance myself from the general public. Not for the first time in my particular case, of course, but seeing as how I'm here, I might as well make the most of our forever crumbling status quo. It's been a really long time since I tried modifying a Petaminx. The last one I did was a pretty piss-poor attempt. It was a candy bowl that I put some M&Ms in, and the one before that was really just a glorified bandage mod. So I hadn't really pushed a Petaminx to its full potential, and I wanted to try a much more complicated build today. I was just coming off the back of a lot of off-camera projects, including one that I really liked, which was the Rhombic Triacontahedron Megaminx. Now that puzzle was a revisit to a particular shape that had trumped me in the past, which was the Rhombic Triacontahedron. I actually failed doing a Terraminx version of this puzzle, so I figured that doing a Petaminx version would be the final nail in the coffin to demonstrate that I can do a lot of stuff now that I couldn't do 6 years ago. Okay, so this is the Petaminx, and for those of you not in the know, peta is of course the Greek prefix. You got mega, giga, terra, peta. And these are all the smaller variations of this puzzle here. Now, the Terraminx was my before-mentioned failure, and not this particular Terraminx. It was actually an MF8 Terraminx. This is a Shengxiao-branded Terraminx, and this is much the same, a Shengxiao-branded Petaminx, which is a higher order. It's 9 layers and many, many, many pieces, all of which are going to be an absolute nightmare. But before I start cutting into this, I've never modified this mechanism before, and whenever you're modifying a puzzle that you've never touched before, it's usually a good idea to open up part of it, just have a little look inside and see what's going on so that you know what you're doing. Now, I want to make a cut from the center, the edge of the centerpiece, all the way to the edge of the other centerpiece, so I need to make sure that I can cut all the way along and remove this material. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tape up a small section here, I'm going to pull this center cap out and then take this chunk out, and then I'm just going to examine those pieces and see if I can actually cut to that depth. Because if I end up cutting too far down, you can't fix that. Plus, this is an expensive puzzle, so I don't want to damage it, or at least not any more than I intend to do. In my head that went better, but it still worked. Wow, it's like the Stargate. The inside mechanism kind of reminds me of Aztec or Mayan artwork. Now, if we focus on this bit here, which is what I want to be looking at, if I was to draw a line from this point here all the way to this point here, that's where I want to cut. And I can see now that I've opened everything up that it's not going to cut anything too important, and that should work just fine. I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't opened this up, and if I had cut into it and it wasn't like this, game over. You've destroyed the puzzle. So now I know that this kind of modification is going to work. It's time to reassemble everything and take it over to the bandsaw. All right, this can go one of two ways. Badly or very badly. Oh my god, it actually worked. Be really nice if I had 24mm. I must have a 24mm lens. No, I don't. 16 it is. Alright, this'll have to do.
Hey, you. You're finally awake.
I reassembled everything, which on a side note would be the quickest and easiest reassembly of this build, and then I peeled all of the tape off to check the movement. After I finished with all of that, I took the puzzle over to my bench so I could start working on it further. Now, the first thing I like to do with my builds, which the initiated of you will well know, is I like to take all the center caps off and begin tightening the puzzle up so that it doesn't turn. The reason I do this is because a twisty puzzle isn't a solid piece of stock. It might feel like a big solid block of plastic, but it's really a load of pieces that are just held together by friction and magic and 12 screws. And if you end up with one of those pieces being snagged on the bandsaw blade, it can end up rapidly disassembling the puzzle and your hands along with it. Seeing as how I like my hands, I didn't want this to happen.
So now that that's done and everything's tightened up, it's time to take it over to the bandsaw here and cut these areas off all around. There's 30 different cuts that I have to make. Well, let's get to it. This is a problem. Alright, so the problemo is this part of the bandsaw, which just so happens to be named the throat, is too small. Story of my life. I can't make a cut to the depth that I want to, and there's no way to get this part to go up any further. I toyed with the idea of modifying it, but seeing as how the bandsaw is an integral part to this build, I don't want to break it. So, what I think I'm going to do is continue the cuts. Once I've cut all of the edges off, I should have removed enough material that I might be able to push it up a little closer to the blade and cut the rest off. It means going from 30 cuts to 60 cuts, but the important thing is I'll be able to get the shape. It's kind of game over if I can't make these cuts, because I can't sand down all this material. Well, I could, but I really don't want to. So, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to keep cutting and pray that this works. Which it very well might not.
See this? This was the problem I was dealing with. I could start a cutoff pretty well, but eventually I'd reach a point where part of the puzzle would hit part of the bandsaw and I'd have to stop. After I'd finished with all the initial cuts, I began cutting the puzzle to its final depth, and this was so dangerous and nerve-wracking, I don't want to show you the actual cuts, but let's just say after every few cuts, I took the puzzle over to my belt sander so I could sand those faces flat. I was doing this because I was using those faces to guide further cuts and I didn't want any errors to compound on themselves, so every few cuts I just made sure everything was up to the correct dimension as I went along. This took a really long time and it actually took me all day just to cut this puzzle to its final shape, but I'm really happy with how it turned out. And after everything was done and all of the pieces were cut and sanded, this is what the puzzle looked like.
Da 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 da! Behold! All of the cuts are done. Unfortunately, I did get a little bit of melting here and there while I was sanding everything, but that is it. That's pretty much the shape, apart from the extensions I'm going to have to do on the centerpieces. I put them back in just because I thought it would look cool, but now what I'm going to do, now that I have everything in the shape that I want, is I'm going to disassemble everything and then begin the arduous, laborious task of cutting all of the melted plastic out of each of the pieces. Once I've done that, I can start filling everything up, but, wow, that looks like a lot of work that I've got ahead of me. Better get to it! Okay, it is time to do the most regrettable part of this build, which is the disassembly. If I can get the center cap off, that is. There we go. You see, this is what happens when all of the plastic melts together. Ends up becoming really hard to disassemble. We shall persevere. Mm.
Look, now you can see the cut lines with a little more detail. Isn't that cool? Alright, it's going to be a little hard to get this in frame or even show up on camera, but this is the top of one of these pieces. And you can see here that this one is pretty much fine. There are no overhangs, and overall, this piece is pretty much ready to go. And more importantly, it's a solid piece of plastic, so I'm not even going to have to fill this piece. But with this piece here, as you can see, there's a big chunk of melted plastic hanging off the side of it, and it's a little asymmetrical. Now, what I have to do for all of the pieces that I've just pulled out of this puzzle is I have to go around and clip all of that stuff off before I can even start thinking about filling any of the pieces. Now, I actually got a start on this a couple days ago, so I'm already quite the way through clipping all of the plastic off each of the pieces, but as you can see here, I still have quite a lot left.
Clipping off all of the melted plastic is a common part of my builds, but it's usually just a small preliminary step before I actually start filling any of the pieces. But seeing as how they had all melted together, this ended up being a pretty big step in its own right, and it wasn't made any easier by the sheer number of pieces. But after I'd finished cleaning all the pieces up, it was now time to sort them out into those that needed to be filled and those that didn't. I said before that some of the pieces were solid plastic, and this was actually a really good thing because this meant that I wouldn't have to fill as many pieces, but I still had to sift through them all and figure out which ones were going to need filling and which ones wouldn't need filling, and more importantly, which ones did kind of look like they needed filling but wouldn't need filling if I sanded them down to the depth that I was going to be sanding down to.
Sometimes I wonder why I didn't just get a real job. Well, the plot twist being that I can work from home, whereas all my friends are on hold with Centrelink. This is taking an incredibly long time. Hey, that was a good tune. You can tell I've completely lost my fucking mind now. Alright, so with all of that done, luckily there are a lot more solid plastic pieces than I initially thought there would be, and that's a good thing because I don't have to fill any of them. Unfortunately, there are still a lot of pieces that need to be filled. But at least with all of my work now somewhat halved, I might be able to get more than one step done in a single day, which should be nice. Alright, so now that is all done, it is time to get the old epoxy sculpt down and mix up a batch and start filling all of these pieces. Now, I know I've already split them up into those that need to be filled and those that don't, but I'm gonna go one further and I'm gonna sift out all of these larger edge pieces here because just these edge pieces alone are probably going to need as much epoxy sculpt as the rest of these pieces combined. And that's just because the cavity inside this piece is so much larger than the tiny little holes inside all of these pieces here. I've done enough of these big minx puzzles to know that usually just these edge pieces alone take up about half the epoxy sculpt.
Filling all of these pieces was really nothing out of the ordinary, although because I was cursed with so many of them, by the time I had finished filling all of the pieces, they had already begun to harden. So I was in a really strange position where I could do all of the filling and all of the sanding in one big step, and that allowed me to save about a day of time waiting around for everything to harden so I could sand it again, and in a project as long and laborious as this one, saving a day here and there really matters, although nothing was going to distract me from the fact that this entire project spanned about 5 months.
This whole lockdown has gotten to me. I moved all of my desks around to here, my old setup, because I like the lighting coming from outside. It's easier to see everything. And, if you're wondering why this video took so long to come out, on top of the break that I already took from making videos, every single one of these steps takes about 3 days to do. All of these pieces, just so many pieces, all have to be treated individually. And now that I have done all of that, it is time to reassemble everything, which should be easy enough. Oh, wait, I'm forgetting something. Now I can start reassembling.
As I was filming the reassembly, I quickly realized that a long time-lapse of me slowly putting together a Petaminx wasn't as entertaining as I first thought, so instead, please enjoy 15 seconds of the Japanese game show Slippery Stairs.
Look, I did a thing. I'm competing with a lot of background noise at the moment, it's raining outside. But I put the center caps on, I totally got the angles wrong, so they're a little steeper than I expected. It kind of looks like the end of a medieval flail. But now that that's all assembled, I've tightened everything up. I did check the turning beforehand, but now that everything's solid, I've made sure, and this is very important, I've made sure that all of the pieces are aligned properly, and everything is, all of the layers are lined up so that if I wanted to make a turn, I wouldn't have to shuffle anything around. That's very important because I only get one shot at sanding this down to its final dimension, and I don't want things to be kind of askew when I do that. So, in the great words of the LGBT community, lesbian.
Look, I broke my maker knife. It used to have a handle thingy on it, but now it's broken. I got this the other day. I was browsing on eBay, as I usually do, and I finally found a tool which I've been meaning to get for a while. Ta-da! It is a jeweler's wooden hand adjustable vise. There's probably just keywords. This is a jeweler's vise or a hand vise or whatever it's called. I'm sure somebody in the comments will tell me. I wanted to get one of these because usually when I'm sanding pieces, I'll fix that later. Usually when I'm sanding pieces, I use needle nose pliers and I have to grip as hard as I can to kind of hold on to an awkward piece so that I can sand it properly, because sometimes it's really hard to hold pieces while you're sanding them. This is gonna make my life better, worse, more complicated, less complicated, I don't know. The important thing is now that I have the tool, I can play around and try and utilize it to the best of my abilities. It would have been really nice to have this before I sanded all of the pieces that I have just finished sanding, but now I have it. Let's continue.
I began sanding down the first of the 30 faces, and I had to be very careful while doing this so that I didn't snag the centerpiece on the belt and accidentally have one of them fly off. And I also had to make sure that everything was going to be level, so I kept flipping it around to make sure that I was sanding both sides equally.
Alright, so similarly to how I made the Rhombic Triacontahedron Megaminx, which I did not make a build video for and still have to do, I've got my first face here. The reason this is important is because this is going to be effectively the metric that I sand all other faces to and measure them from. So I'm going to mark this one with an X, and that tells me that this face is done. So I don't have to sand it anymore, I don't have to make any adjustments to it. Now all I have to do is get all of the other remaining 29 faces to the same depth. And in order to do that, I have to very incrementally sand little bit by little bit. And if I go too far, well, I've got to not go too far. Alright, so I got the second face done. And as you can see, I've tried to mirror this face to this one as best I can. And even still, you can see there are some very, very subtle differences between the size of some of these pieces, particularly this small ridge on the center cap here is slightly thicker than the same ridge on this center cap. It's never going to be 100% perfect, and if you try and make it perfect, then you'll end up sanding too far. I'm just going to leave this as is because I think it's good enough. When you're sanding a puzzle, probably not something this big, but when you're sanding something on the belt sander, the bit facing you tends to sand a little faster than the bit behind you. This is because the travel of the belt is pulling one side down into the belt. So I often put pressure on the back to try and alleviate that problem and equal everything out. But if I put too much pressure on, then I end up sanding the back bit down. That's why I'm constantly putting it down, checking it, putting it back down, and doing that again and again. The nuance of where you put pressure on the puzzle and how the belt slowly grinds all of the plastic and epoxy sculpt away is how you go about slowly refining that shape and getting it to where you want it to be. And it's very hard to do, but not impossible. The day has become the night, my pleasure has become my plight. It's a broken. I'm cutting back and forth because I've finished all of the sanding by viewer's logic, but I've only sanded about 5 faces here, and I took the puzzle in because it's nighttime and I'd prefer to sand in the day where there's better lighting, and I just decided to loosen up the tensions a little bit, kind of jiggle around what I've already sanded so that I can offset any high or low points, try and get the shape down a little better. And I have noticed something that I should have picked up on when I assembled this to begin with, but I think it might be because I've tightened it up a little too much. I've actually busted one of these center stalks inside the center piece. So here's my problemo. So you can see here that this is the screw that holds the centerpiece in place. Now there's a small piece of plastic around this, and it's actually a cylinder that encompasses the screw and extends down some way. Why they manufacture the piece that way, I don't know. But the head of the screw is a smaller diameter than this circle, but it rests on a ridge that is smaller than the diameter of the head of the screw. So when I tightened it all the way down, it kind of pushed against that and it pushed a piece of the plastic out. Now, I'm not actually sure if this is a problem, but I don't like it because a small split here can eventually become a big split as this fracture line finds its way down the cylinder, and eventually it can bust the whole piece open. And as an integral part of this entire puzzle, I would hate to have something that I'd spent as long as I have explode while somebody was solving it. So this is something that I've got to fix. How can we fix this? But how can fire undo stone? I think the best way to fix this is by pushing the piece of plastic back and then shimming it in place. I guess we're just gonna have to figure out how to do that. Stupid like a fox. Perfect. This stuff might work, but I think it's a little too thin and fragile, and it's also compressible. The graphite, on the other hand, that will work.
God damn it. Ah, crap. Graphite. The only lubricant that isn't fun. Alright, I want to put this piece in here. And push it down. Whoops. Nearly broke a cardinal rule. Never, ever, 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 ever drip superglue directly into a piece while the puzzle is assembled. You run the risk of pressing a little too hard on the tube, accidentally letting out much more than you expected, which I've done more times than I like to admit, and you end up binding the mechanism and you just can't fix that. And on one of these, I'm gonna avoid that at all costs. So I like to drip a little bit of super glue onto a sticky note or really any surface, use a blade to pick up a small amount of that super glue, you don't need much, and then use that to apply it. I think that should work. And if it does, then that makes this something that I know how to do. You see, whenever I do these large builds, really they're small builds with more pieces. I'm not really learning anything new. That was something that I didn't know how to do before that I do know how to do. It might not work, it might not hold as well as I thought, I might have to reiterate it, but the important thing is that all of these little lessons and things that you learn throughout your life are like bricks in a wall, and you, my friend, are a cathedral under construction. I'm gonna leave that to dry, and I'm probably gonna go back over it just to make sure that it solidifies properly. And that should be it. I think I can go back to building now.
8 hours later.
Alright, so a little bit has occurred between the then and the now. After I finished sanding everything, I took it over to my desk here, I loosened everything up, scrambled it all up, just kind of offset all of the high and the low points, and then I realigned everything, tightened it all up, and I sanded it down some more. And now it is perfect, or as perfect as I'm gonna get it. So now that I have everything completed, it's time to disassemble the puzzle and start rounding over all of the pieces. I'm pretty much on the downhill run of this entire modification so far. But while I'm rounding over all of the pieces, I'm also gonna be separating out all of the pieces that need some repairs, just little holes and nicks here and there, and I'm gonna fill all of those up as I go along. I kinda wanna roll it around like this, but I'm afraid it might break. I need to make like a D&D mod or something like that. Where's my screwdriver? You really would think I'd be used to this by now, but you never get used to disassembling puzzles this big. I always forget that whenever I tighten these puzzles up, disassembling them isn't just a case of taking out one centerpiece. They're all pretty much completely tightened, so I have to loosen them all as I go along if I'm actually going to get anything out of this. Also, because I've sanded down into, and this is kind of hard to see, because I've sanded down into the centerpiece just ever so slightly, I am going to have to take all of the centerpieces out and treat them as pieces to be sanded as well. It only adds 12 more pieces to the list of pieces that I have to round off, but that does mean that I have to take them all out of the core. It's not a problem. It's just an observation. It's like, in Ratchet and Clank, when Drek is trying to build a new planet out of pieces of other planets, this is what that planet looks like when it's partially under construction. There you go. There's a glimpse into my mind. There's all these flavors in the world, but I choose to be salty. These turned up at my house today. Kathleen, who's been a huge supporter of the channel, hi Kathleen, she actually sent me the stickers that I'm going to use to sticker this bad boy up. She bought these puzzles from me like 2 months ago, and they didn't arrive, and I felt really bad, so I made her some new ones, and I sent those out to her as replacements. Literally the next day, these were returned to me. So they're just sticker mods, I know, but well, at least I get to either resell them now, or I might gift them out at my next competition. We'll see what happens.
It was at this moment I decided to grow a mustache.
I can't stand this. Look at what I have to deal with. So this is the dynamic range of my camera. I can be perfectly illuminated with my crazy hair, but if I want to show the outside, I have to reduce the brightness. This is why dynamic range is important. Alright, so here's what I gotta deal with. I've disassembled everything. I've already kind of gotten a bit of a head start on the pieces, but I've been dealing with a very subtle problem, which is, if I can find a good example in here, this here, look. Where is my 100mm lens? Right, so this is one of the pieces that has been sanded, and it's got the divide between one face and another on it. It's very hard to see. It's very hard to keep this in frame, but you can see that the two sloped surfaces don't meet directly in the center. Now, this isn't a problem, but it is something that I have to fix. You see, all of the pieces, they're gonna be about half a millimeter off, maybe not even, which isn't a problem. I've kind of done this enough to know that that's not a game changer when it comes to reassembling all of these pieces. It just being slightly off is something that you don't really notice that much. But it is a problem for all of the pieces that divide one face to another, and so what I need to do is I have to take a blade and I have to go through with all of these pieces, and I just have to peel that higher surface away until everything lines up perfectly. I'm only shaving off the barest, tiniest amount of plastic, which is why it's all but invisible on the finished product, but I have to do that many, many times, because if it isn't perfect, you'll see it, and I don't want you to see it. All of these pieces have been sanded to within about a quarter of a millimeter of where they need to be, but there are always going to be subtle mismatches. There's nothing I can do to stop that. All I can do is, as I'm finishing the pieces, go one by one and try and shave off as much material as I can to make each piece as perfect as possible. And it's never more apparent than on pieces that divide the surface, or the level of one surface to another. This is all very complicated.
After I'd finished repairing all of those pieces, it was time to round over all of the sharp edges on each of the rest of the pieces, and so I used my tried and tested method of a sanding block as well as a nail file and some Scotch-Brite.
Also, fun fact, if you find yourself in a pickle and you can't use Scotch-Brite, burnishing it on your jeans works just as well. You can use one or the other. I like to use both. Okay, so we are done sanding all of these pieces. It doesn't look like it, but this took me 4 days to finish. So I am very glad to see that done. But I still have these pieces here. Now all of these, and they're mostly centerpieces just because I was too steep on the extension, and so I kind of didn't fill some of these areas here, and I have to repair them. There's also some smaller pieces in here that just have little holes on them that I need to repair. So before I can reassemble the puzzle with all of these pieces, I gotta fix this stuff first. So that's what I'm gonna do now. And in order to do that, I'm gonna need some of the wonderful epoxy sculpt.
I mixed up a small amount of epoxy sculpt and I filled all the holes in each of the pieces and then I left them overnight to harden. After everything had hardened up, I used a blade to scrape off the majority of the epoxy sculpt and then I sanded down the rest of the way with a sanding block. After I'd done that, I rubbed each of the pieces down with some Scotch-Brite and they were all repaired.
Okay, so now all the pieces have been repaired and they've also been rounded over, it's finally time to start reassembling the puzzle. Which is the sentence that I'd like to be saying if there wasn't another problem. You see, when I was sanding down the centerpieces, I brought the center cap, which is of course what the extension here is built upon, a little too far in, and as a result, it's squishy. Every single time I think I'm getting somewhere, I discover another problem. I haven't put a video out in 5 months. Why don't you guys subscribe to me? So let me better explain what this problem is. I mentioned before that I sanded into the center pieces while I was sanding the extensions on the center cap down. And the reason that that's now a problem is because when the center cap is unmodified, there's a small lip of plastic that extends over top of the centerpiece that prevents the cap from sinking down into it. And when I sanded that away, if I push hard enough, it can just sink down into the centerpiece. Now, there's quite a bit of force needed to get it to do this, but the fact it can do it in the first place is a problem that I want to fix. And now I just have to figure out how to do that. I think the best way to fix this would be probably just to make a little support inside that prevents this from going down into the piece, and that's pretty easy to do. I can make that out of epoxy sculpt. The problem is, if I do that, then it's probably going to bind the center cap to the center piece and remove access to the screw. So, I'll have to reassemble everything, get it to the correct tensions, and then I'll have to do the repair. So this will probably be the last thing that I do before stickering. Well, I guess that means I can start reassembling everything now. I feel like Sisyphus just constantly rolling the boulder up the mountain. Ah, God. Every time I feel like I'm getting somewhere, there's more to do. But that's only because there's only one way to do this, and that's doing it properly. Considering I've spent so long building this thing now, I won't settle for anything less than the right way to do things. That's what I tell myself to sleep at night. Every single time I think I've found the piece that I'm looking for, I've just found the mirror image of that piece. Alright, so I just got done repairing most of these centerpieces, but I realized I hadn't filmed anything yet, so what I'm doing here is I'm just scraping up two of the inside surfaces. It's kind of hard to show you what I'm doing, but I'm just trying to create a key so that the epoxy sculpt can stick in there. And what I'm going to do is put two small pieces of epoxy sculpt inside the centerpiece, and I'm going to press them up against the sides of the centerpiece wall. And hopefully that should be enough to support the centerpiece, or the center cap rather, as it's set in place. And within 8 hours or so when that hardens, I'll never be able to remove the center cap again, but at least it will be at the correct height forever. And I've already gone through and checked the tensions to make sure everything is good, and so that should be the last time I have to deal with that. Ta-da! I have finally finished repairing all 12 of the center caps. Each one of them had 5 little holes that I had to fill in them, and they're all sanded and done. And now that everything to do with the puzzle is complete, it is time to do all of the stickers. I should point out, though, it doesn't really matter how many colors I'm going to be using. Although there are 30 faces, and I would like there to be a correlation between the number of colors I use and the number of faces on the puzzle, I'm not going to be obeying the cut lines or the geometry of the faces in any way.
Before I started cutting out all of the stickers, I was already at peace with the fact that this was going to take the best part of a week to get all of the stickers cut by hand, but there really wasn't another way to get it done. Because I wanted to do a Chaos color scheme, I wasn't sure what the unfurled net of that color scheme would look like, and so I couldn't just take a picture of one of the faces, send it over to Oliver from Oliver's Stickers, and then get him to cut all those stickers out for me. I had to actually do them one by one so that I could figure out where all of the colors would be. And even though that was going to take a really long time, it gave me enough time to properly think out the color scheme so that I ended up with a load of colors that blended into one another and gave me a somewhat chromatic color scheme, where blue would blend into green and that would blend into yellow, which would blend into sort of the warmer colors. I tried not to go for a warm-cold scheme, but I just like the look of all of the colors blending into one another, and this is the final result. I had to superglue all of the small stickers on, so it took an extra couple days just to make sure that some didn't slip off, and I did lose a few stickers here and there, so I had to go back and cut some, but overall, this is the final result, and I'm really happy with how the puzzle looks. I mean, I'd want to be happy, seeing as how it's taken me almost half a year to build this damn thing, but I'll be honest, the majority of this build has been on and off between a lot of other off-camera projects, so really it took me about an entire month worth of work. If I was to sit down and properly focus on this modification, I was just building a lot of other stuff behind the scenes. And the majority of what I didn't film was just days on end of sanding, sorting, reassembling, and a healthy amount of swearing. But I was just determined to make this puzzle as good as I imagined it when I first started this build back in March. The first time I set out to make a rhombic triacontahedron, that was the Petaminx, and I failed miserably at that, giving up just partway through the initial shaping, and for 6 years, I didn't think I was capable of finishing a project of that size. But not only did I prove myself wrong, I went one better by building a higher order version, and I even gave it a color scheme worthy of the success. I mean, just look at all the colors. I'm afraid to do even a few moves on this thing because I won't be able to solve it if I scramble even part of it. And no, I can't disassemble it, so... yeah, there's that. And I also can't forget to thank Oliver from Oliver's Stickers and Kathleen for both donating sticker vinyl for me to finish this project. I don't think I would have been able to get all of the stickers cut without all of the expansive colors to choose from. I needed to dip into both of those to actually get all of the right colors to make that nice chromatic color scheme. I suppose this project was spurred along by the fact that I hadn't been able to leave my house for half the time I've been building this thing, and over the almost unavoidable pandemic going on around me, I've had some much needed time away from YouTube, and I'm glad to be back. I think it's fair to say that a project of this size won't be something that I'll be revisiting anytime soon. The high piece count just makes mods like this take way longer than they should, and there has to be at least a few hundred pieces in this thing. But the main thing that I take away from this project is that I've done so many of these puzzle modifications now that something which was once impossible to me is now not only possible, I can build something even better. And if that's the case, I can't wait to see what I'll be building 6 years from now. So thank you all for watching. And I'll see you next time.
Well, I fucked that one up, didn't I?
I don't want to set the world on fire. I just want to be the flame in your heart.
I swear to God, if I can't get this back to its original solved state, I'm just gonna end it all right now.